Today is August 22nd, 2001. I'm interviewing Henry Mikols. My name is Jill M. Greenberg. I'm in Waltham, Massachusetts in the United States, and this interview is being conducted in English. Today is August 22nd, 2001. I'm interviewing Henry Mikols. We're in Waltham, Massachusetts in the United States. My name is Jill Greenberg, and this interview is being conducted in English. Mr. Mikols, what is your earliest remembrance of growing up in Poland?
I remember since I was 10 years old, going to school, enjoying all the festivities in Polish language, including holidays. I remember my mother's cooking, when she used to cook babka. I remember when she was putting the dough in a pot. Me and my brother used to use fingers, used to lick it around because we liked it, the taste so much. There was many food and Polish dishes that I have missed in this world because only mother was the best cooking.
Are there any holidays that you remember in particular as being your favorite?
Yes, around Christmas time, Easter time, and my mother's birthday holiday, which was on May 24th, and we always got together, tried to buy the mother present. We found a little jobs just to earn some money to be able to conclude those festivities into a closure.
What kind of present did you buy her?
Well, it was simple dishes, decanters with glasses, wine glasses, and whatever we could afford it at that time. After all, when you're 10 or 12 years old, you don't make very much money.
What kind of business was your father in?
At the early years, when I was 3 years of age, my father was in a movie business, silent movies, and the name of his cinema was Kino Wilsona. Wilson is the movie was named after our President Wilson from America, who have been visited Poland and he helped Polish people so much. They named the big huge park after President Wilson. And across the street was the little movie house where my father started the silent movies. He used to buy movies in Switzerland, in France, brought it to Poland. And that's the way he started in the cinema business.
Did a lot of people like to go to the movies?
At that time, the whole Europe liked it because there was novelty. Just like if you invented the television screens, at that time, there was a pastime. People in Poland walk a lot. We didn't have as many cars as in the United States. So I remember those days, you've seen the whole town on the sidewalk. And movies was something, a novelty. I remember Charlie Chaplin, and I remember all those old movies, even Buck Jones. We used to get movies from America, cowboys and Indians, and that was fascinating me. Matter of fact, later on in the future, I used to see in fantasy about United States of America, how aeroplane landed on a roof, which meant the helicopters. And that always fascinates me. That's why I was so anxious to come to the United States one of these days. And here I am.
What kinds of activities did you play as a boy?
As a boy, I joined the Boy Scouts. Boy Scouts was part of discovering Poland in greater forests, and we been supervised by nuns and teachers, volunteers, during the summer vacation, school vacations, of course. And that was the best pastime of my life because our parents were able to come and visit us. The activities where we were was merely two stations from Poland, where my father could come on a bicycle even, and so forth. So it was great to see our parents together, but for me, that was part of the upbringing. I was just starting to wear from short pants to long pants. I thought I was a man already.
What did you study in school?
Well, in school, I learned Polish history. I learned about famous people like Copernicus, Paderewski, who used to play piano, Pulaski, who they named bridge in New York after him, Kosciuszko, General Kosciuszko, who used to fought with George Washington during the civil wars in America. And Poland was admired by United States, and our politicians stayed close to Washington. Therefore, Poland was always like a favor to the outside world.
Did you have any Jewish friends while you were growing up?
Oh yes, we went to school together. In our building, there was two young boys our age. We used to play cowboys and Indians. their fathers used to be merchants, and they we used to have a kayak together. As a matter of fact, one of the boys donated enough material where we could build a sail. You see, we tried to go across the Warta. Warta was the river that goes right through Poznań. I always remember that. And my activities was to earn a little money, and one of these days we met a fellow who, his name was Herr Schneider. He was a tailor, and he asked my parents if I would like to do some work for him, he would pay me. What he was doing, he was working in his own house, and he has manufactured clothing, parts of clothes and suits and so forth. He made the packages and sent it to another Jewish fellow who completed them. And my job was to take those packages a block and a half to a bus station where the packages were going to a certain destination. And of course, that was one of my part-time job where I earned a little money, and I was able to buy my mother a present for her name's day. And occasionally I worked for my uncle, which was my father's brother. He was a painter. I helped him carry ladders up third floor floors and paint. And occasionally I went into learning what the trades was all about.
While you were growing up, you were Roman Catholic. And I asked you a little bit before about the holidays you celebrated. Did you ever remember watching Jewish families celebrating their holidays?
Oh, yes, yes. And it was heartbroken for me because I had so many Jewish friends. Matter of fact, we used to trade in a Jewish store our uniform for future gymnasium, they call it, which was high school in Poland. My mother bought a uniform, and this Jewish merchant extended us a credit. You didn't have to pay cash. Like Polish merchant, you had to go pay cash for everything. We went to this Jewish store, and you pay so much down, and when you ready pay, you had the uniforms. And that's the way we were able to buy our stuff, and we were dealing with them. But like on Saturday, when the merchants and the Jewish people had the Sabbath, I seen that a bunch of hoodlums used to throw stones at the church, and that was really heartbroken. I could not understand what hatreds could lead to, and my father told me that they are really Germans instigators. You see, my city of Poznań was German-oriented. My mother and father went to German schools. My grandfather and grandmother were living under Kaiser Wilhelm. And Kaiser Wilhelm, who was the leader of Germany, had his own little theaters and all the warehouses. They used to call my city of Poznań the Speisekammer, you know. Speisekammer is a warehouse of food and all the goodies, you see. And we have great theaters and stage shows in Poland. And my father would save money whole month so he can buy two tickets to go to theater. And him and my mother, of course, you see. And
what was the relationship between the German people and the Polish people?
Well, the Germans were hiding that they were Germans. They were German descent, born in Poland, and they were educated in Polish schools. They become high-ranking officers. That's why when the time come to 1939, they gave the orders to dismantle engines, airplanes, while the Germans came over and start bombing us.
Why were the Germans hiding that they were German?
Well, they actually were not hiding. They had German names. But the Germans went to Polish schools. They spoke both languages. They spoke Polish and German, the same as we learned from my parents, apparently. But I'm only saying this for a particular reason what has led to future happenings that happen in Poland. Apparently were getting along with everybody. Poland is a Christian nation. Poland is 80% Catholics, and we would let him a helping hand to anybody who crosses our path. And in this world, as you know, we all have to live together, otherwise we'll be isolated.
When did you first get a sense that war was coming, that something was changing?
Very good. My father told me one time, towards the end of 1939 in August, that Polish flyers, aeroplane, will perform maneuvers, acrobatic sessions of a city of Poznań. So he took me to the top of the roof. It was a flat roof on a third floor. And we were expecting to see those planes in the acrobatic session. And we seen planes coming in with the Polish emblems on the wings. And we were waving to them. And all of a sudden we hear a boom, boom. They were destroying Poznań. They were bombing our airfields. And my father says, no, those are not Polish planes, those are Germans. You never seen two guys making down to the cellar in 2 minutes. That's the way we sensed at first about something imminent, was that the Germans were coming to Poznań, Poland. And around September 8, we seen the Polish army was retreating, abandoning us, women and children and elderly people. And we've seen the bridges being destroyed over the water of Warta. They bombed the bridges. Our Polish army, they wanted to slow down the impact of the German army. And around the 8th of September, there we come, we've seen German coming with the tanks and the motorcycles. They put a machine gun on every corner. You see, I lived in the centrum of town where the big city hall was staying, and there was a big market all around. We call it that place Stary Rynek. That was the old marketplace where everybody got it, buy vegetables, and butcher shops were there and everything. So they invaded that center of town. And all of a sudden, to my amazement, I never knew there were so many Germans in my city. They were greeting those German soldiers, throwing flowers at them, and we were watching in from the windows, and my mother was crying, my father was nervous, and I stood there at them. I went to my piano and play Jeszcze Polska nie zginęła, that's the Polish national anthems. During that time, and my mother said, shh, because they may hear us. I didn't care. I was very patriotic about my country, my heritage, my historical value that I learned in my schools. We No, we knew then that if you want to get someplace, school is the only answer, education is the only answer. And that was the beginning that I found that there was prejudice that was really exposing me. I wrote notes, I seen notes being written down on the posters, all Polish people must give up their radios. They stripped us from communications with the world. They made us give up our own radios. And that's God's honest truth. There were posters with executions, people that were against the Germans. They were arrested. They were either shot or sent to an area where they never been found again. So we feared that. They put the fear right into our mind where we had to behave. And there was, war was, they were already in it, 1939, August, September, October, November, the 3 months we experienced all the German infiltration. December 23rd, they banged on our doors and they told us, rouse, 5 minutes, you have to pack whatever you can carry. And you see, it took very little to start a rumor, the Jewish people living here. And we need the room for the German people. They thought actually that we were Jewish.
Why did they think you were Jewish?
Because we had a nice apartment. We live in a nice central location, located apartment, you see. And it didn't take higher ups to evict us. They would tell to a couple of gendarmes over there, couple of soldiers, they will come down, bang on your door, and evict you right out of your own home.
Was there a difference? You mentioned that they thought you were Jewish, but was there a difference in terms of how the Germans treated the Jewish people as opposed to the non-Jewish people?
Well, yes. Apparently, all the Jewish people, whoever could escape before the Germans came, including my friends and the two friends that were living in my house, they left for Switzerland 2-3 months before the war started. Apparently, they knew what was happening. But the Polish people were also mistreated, and they had been told, the women especially and children, pregnant women, you must leave Poznań, you must go to Protectorate. Protectorate they created around Krakow, around Lodz. They promised that the Germans took us plane will not bomb that area. So I remember that word, Protectorate. And as we were leaving the city to go join the road towards Krakow, we seen people coming back already with the family. So it was a mixed up. You've seen Polish army, soldiers, wounded people coming back back to the city. There was not enough Germans to control all this influx of people. And that's why we decided to turn back and go to my father's sister's house to hide.
When you were told you had to leave, what did you take with you?
One little pillow, my favorite pillow, and a pair of slippers and a blanket. My mother tried to get it, whatever we could. We had to leave our possessions, our furniture, our pictures, portraits, whatever we had, and a little suitcase. And my mother spoke German, you know, that's why we got away with the 5 extra minutes they gave us, because my mother was speaking German to them. They went to school and so forth. You see, you had to baffle them a little bit, otherwise you get nowhere. Just like when you went in line for food, my mother went in line, but she spoke German. They thought my mother was German. That's why she got a little butter, she got a little marmalade and a couple of breads, you know. This is the true story. That's the way it happened in 1939.
When they came to tell you, your family, that basically you had to leave your apartment because they thought you were Jewish, did your parents try to convince them that they were not Jewish?
My parents asked them, why us, why us? The whole block's being evacuated for German headquarters. That's what we understood they told us. But of course, I didn't hear that because we were packing things and my mother was still talking to him, and they the soldiers who were there with guns, and you don't give them lips or any excuses. You see, it says, "Raus, mach schnell." That was the expressions that they had, you know. And that was 11 o'clock at night time. We were already sleeping, you know. So the next morning, we were in my aunt's house. She was in charge of a complex apartment. She was like a rent collector, okay? She was in charge with the heating system, and that's where my father came in. She offered him a job, but so the Germans know that he's employer here in this building. Without him, the building be cold. So that's the way they didn't bother my father and my mother. But I was next in line. They were looking for youngsters. You have anybody 16-year-olds and so forth? And my mother says, nine. We were hiding. That was from December 23rd to about May. I didn't even go on the street. But finally, when things were tough, we needed bread, I decided to take a vengeance and go out.
Where was your aunt's house that she was allowed to stay there and you were allowed to go there?
About a block and a half on the outskirts of the centrum of a town.
Okay.
You see, they wanted to control the central town. The Rathaus, which is the city hall of Poland, was very valuable because it's a historical place. The Turks tried to invade it and they couldn't because they were throwing rocks at them. And I'm talking about in the 18th, 17th centuries, maybe.
While you were hiding at your aunt's house, what did you do?
Well, we were reading books. We tried to be helpful. We had a little hidden radio, listening to radio from London, shortwave radio, which was punishable by death because at the beginning we already had to give up our radios. So that was the entertainment. We had a little checker games. We had little games me and my brother were playing, you see. We did our own laundry. We had to do the laundry and dry it inside, not outside. And there were not many youngsters walking around the streets.
What did you have to eat during that time?
Well, whatever my mother was able to scrape and scrape from my aunt, and usually the Polish people shared, just like if there was the Last Supper, you know. And my mother used to cook. She'd go to the market, wherever she buys half of those yellow squash, and she made soup out of that and made some dumplings. And if you're hungry with anything, yes.
Okay. Was it hard for you?
Yes, mine was bewildered. I did not understand why that happened to me. You see, for my parents, it was the second time around because they lived through World War I. For me, I was in my country. That was my country. That was my town. How could somebody come and take me away from that? I could not understand that. But later on, when they smack you across your face, and they call you Schweine Polacken, which means dirty Polacks, you know, pig Polack they used to call us. And I could not understand. I turned to my God, I start praying. I says, "My God, what's happening?" You know. But the realization came to, because we found out what this is all about, and we knew we become a slave in my own country. We had to live with that, to survive, because we've seen people mistreated on the streets. We hear of them, people being arrested, beaten up. Matter of fact, the fellow where we lived was a restaurateur. He used to run a big bar, and even the Germans SS used to go there. They were apparently doing, when you drink something, he must have said, he was arrested for it. And he came up with the blue eyes, and that's what, I haven't seen him, but my father told me that they released him finally because he needed the medical attention. So when you figure beatings, and there was only short few, five, 6 months, because In 1940, May of 1940, I was caught on the street trying to go to a bakery to buy some bread. And what they did, the Nazi stormtroopers came and blocked all the streets and pick up all the youngsters who were strong enough, big enough, 14 and over, to be sent to Germany.
Why did you go out if you knew that it was dangerous?
I took a chance because we were hungry, and I knew that baker who we deal with for so long, that baker would sell me a little bread under the table. And my mother says, no, don't go there, there's dangers. Before she had a chance to say that, those words, I was already riding the rails, you know, there was a rails down around the stairways. I used to sit on the rails and ride it down. I didn't even walk through the steps. And I was out on the street, and there was a clear day, nice day. And I was walking to the bakery, and from the bakery with a loaf of the bread, I keep nibbling on some of it already. I was hungry. And I was about half an hour from my house, and that's where the stormtrooper invaded us, picked up every youngster from the street, loaded us into a truck, sent us to a medical examination for checkup, and that's the last time I see my parents.
What did you think when they picked you up?
I could not understand, but there was interpreter assuring us that you're going to Germany, you'll be working, you make money. I said, well, it can't be that bad, you know. We thought Germany was culture country. Perhaps, you know, they will have a little mercy on a younger generation. But with me, I said, well, work. I don't mind working. But I didn't know that I would become a slave.
What kind of work did they tell you were going to be doing?
They didn't tell us nothing. They took us on a train to Fulda. In Fulda, quarter of a train was unloaded for future farmers, generations. Then the train went to another couple of stations to Alsfeld. And Alsfeld, we were unloaded, and some of them was transported by truck. We were transported by truck to farmers. And the farmers came out, we were there, they used to play lottery with us. They put numbers up, and whoever number matches with the farmer, that's the farmer you went in. We become a possessions of the German farmers.
Tape 2, this is August 22nd, 2001. I'm interviewing Henry Mikols. My name is Jill Greenberg. We're in Waltham, Massachusetts, and this interview is being conducted in English. Mr. Mikols, what was the first farm or farmer that you stayed with like?
Well, the first farmer, I wind up actually a little town by the name Oberreichenbach by Hanau. That's where I was taken to the first farmer. When I arrived there, the next morning, 5 o'clock, he banged on my door. He says, Raus, aufstehen, means get up. And I had only one little lightweight clothing with the shiny shoes. And I came out, I didn't know what happened. He says, come and see here. Come over here. He takes me to the cow stall, He handles me a wheelbarrow and a fork, he says, to make it clean, to clean up behind the cows. I look at this and I start jumping. I didn't want to dirty my shoes, you know, and he wanted me to clean up the mess. I says, my God, what is he doing to me? But I learned fast when he grabbed me and slapped me once, you know, then I pay attention, you know. Then finally, I got different pair of boots and some overalls that he gave me, and I learned how to clean behind cows. Then he took me to a field where he was plowing and put grains in it, because that was in May. At that time, farmers used to sow grain and stuff like that. And he had a couple of horses. Occasionally, he takes me in the woods to take the trees out of the woods because he was building a new barn. For new barn, the German government used to allow him take so much wood out of the woods, and he had carpenters, and they installed his barn for the harvest.
Do you remember his name?
Schroeder. I have it written down someplace, but I didn't want to remember his name. He was really no good to me.
Were there any other young Polish boys with you?
Yes, there was four or five of us, but four of us decided to run away one Sunday afternoon. So we got it, a little bread, a little German wurst with sausage, and we get lightweight, whatever. We had to leave everything because at Sunday afternoon we were able to have spent 3-4 hours to ourselves for supper. And that's why I decided to run away right at the beginning. The four of us were running away, and of course I disappeared. They didn't know where I was. We slept in the fields, in the sheds, wherever we could hide. And of course we went almost at least 100 kilometers away from them. And then one of these days we had blisters, actually had blisters on our feet and all that. We were hungry, we had nothing to eat. There was more than a week since we were away. And the German police man on a bicycle spotted us. He hit right for us. We tried to run away, but he caught our friend, and we decided all for one, and one for all, and one for all for one. So we give up, and he took us to a temporary prison, and he tried to find out where we come from. But so happened, I received a letter at that time from my family with this new address, Schrener, whatever his name was. I had a letter that my grandmother passed away, and I loved her so much, and I was heartbroken, and that's what actually triggered me to run away from him to go back to Poland. So we didn't go to Poland. We never made it to Poland because they moved us to another farm. We were so young that they did not send us to concentration camp or prison again. They needed the labor force on those farms because they took the German boys to the army. So somebody had to take the, that's where we come in. We were taught how to run and work on a farm, on a forced labor, let's put it that way. Yeah.
What did they feed you while you were working so hard on the farm?
In the morning, they give you a slice of bread with a mousse, with jam, and a cup of coffee, and that's all was the breakfast. We had to attend to horses and cows and feed them and that, and sharpen blades to sickles to go cut grass, and was all kind of chores. Then around noontime, one of the wife came over with a little basket, and she brought a little cheese and little sausage and little bread. That was like a second breakfast, more or less, and a lunch. It was a lunch, American lunch, let's put it that way. And we worked all day till the sunset. And after that, we came back, attended to the animals, and occasionally they cooked some soup there, and they potatoes with onions and nothing elaborate that we ate, but it was enough to survive. I wish I had that food in concentration camp.
You mentioned that you had received a letter from home, so it sounds like your parents knew where you were.
Yes, because when I arrived, I could, number one, we were not allowed to write in Polish. So in 3 months, I had to learn how to speak the German language, copy the address, mine and father, und mine and mother, alles is good. 3 words, everything is okay, you know. And I have my address of my aunt to Poznań, and my father tried to write a letter to the farmer because they spoke written in German language. So they tried to butter the farmer a little bit so he'd be good to me. Well, that didn't actually make much influence. So when I was caught and sent it to another farm, Untersorg by Alsfeld, that was the address. And his name, this farmer's name was Heinrich Eiflender. He had 2 daughters who worked as a family affair, 2 daughters, and was a German boy who was going to the army. I was his replacement. That's why I know that what they were doing. Then they had a couple of girls, Arbeitsdienst. There were German girls who volunteer work on a farm to keep the farms going. You see, those farmers, they had, everything was registered at that time. They knew how many chickens you have, how many eggs you had to donate to the army, milk, butter, grain, everything. Every farmer was received the help of foreigners so he can donate to the contingent as far as to feed the German army. And that was pretty well the story on the German farm. And that second farmer was pretty good to me because he has been in Poland during the First World War. He keeps saying a couple of words in Polish. Masło, jajka means butter and eggs. And then my father and mother wrote him a letter too. And after they received the letter, their attitude towards me changed a little bit. They were...
The attitude of the farmer.
Of the second farmer, yes. And I wanted to go for vacation to Poland after 1 year. He promised me when 1 year you work here, we will see what we can do for you. But that was 1940, and I worked to him for a year and a half. And when he tried to give me vacations or holiday, the German government says, nein, you're supposed to arbeit, working in Germany. So I was brokenhearted again and so forth. And I did keep in contact with my parents. And all of a sudden, what happened, working for the farmer at nighttime, he puts on the radio the German news, all we hear about the German that is how many ships they sank, British ships and all that. And even my farmer was laughing and shaking his head, you see. But then while we were making those in the living room, we were making brooms from the horse's hair and stuff like that. That's what he taught me, how to make sweeping brooms. And then he went to bed, so I kind of sneak in. I turned another station, there was shortwave radio. I picked up a station from Milano, Italy, in Polish language. And that's why I hear the language being spoken in Polish. I knew the preparations of invasions on Sicily. All those news, I used to make a little notation and I used to share that with my friends, but later on I learned to memorize it. And the friends I met, I spread the news among them that the war, it's near, you know, perhaps we'll be free soon. There is other countries involved.
You mentioned that even the farmer would listen to this news of supposed German victories and would shake his head, and you sort of indicated, yeah, knew it wasn't true. How would you know that it's not true? Why didn't you think it was true?
Well, he told me that I hear in conversation, because by then I picked up the German language. I could understand much more in a few more months than... I've been there, after all, for almost a year and a half to 2 years. And when they invaded Russia, I was still working on a farm. And my farmer says to his wife, The Krieg ist verloren. The war is gone when invaded Russia, because he knew what Russia was all about. It. The German army was not prepared to fight Russia. Maybe they were prepared to fight the Russians, but they were not prepared to fight the climate in the wintertime. Napoleon made the same mistake. He had to leave Russia because of the weather, you see. And I seen a hear of German boys coming from Russian front with frozen noses, ears, and stuff like that. And that was shortly before that, that I was on my merry-go-round spreading propaganda. They caught us outside the town. There was a curfew in the town. We had to wait, pee.
What does pee mean?
Polish, you Ukrainian, are Russian, gypsy, tsigoine, yeah, gypsy, and Jewish were wearing stars. You see, even though we were not in concentration camp, but they already made a mockery out of us. They wanted the other Germans to know who we were, what Icelander, they say, who, what type of foreigners we were, you see.
Were foreigners from different places treated differently?
No. There was one statistic. You either work, you behave. If not, you go either to prison or you disappear. You didn't know, nobody hear of you. That's what happened to me. This one Ukrainian mentioned to this German policeman that I was spreading propaganda against the German government, listening to radio broadcasts and telling others. So that's why I was arrested for more or less espionage and spreading propaganda against German government, like self-proclaimed underground. That was me.
Where were you actually when you were arrested?
On the farm. They were waiting for me. They gave me the last supper there. They gave me a coffee and a German Kuchen that I liked. And
you mean, when you say they, who is they?
The farmer. The farmer's daughter. They pronounced, they put everything on a table, so I had a few sticks of Kuchen. But I felt something funny because they were not the same. They gave me the food and they disappeared. After I ate the cake and the coffee, my farmer says, there's somebody in the living room wants to talk to you. So I'm walking in there. There is the guy, the Stadtpolizei with a helmet around it and this gray uniform. And he says to me, do you spend lots of time in this room? I says, yeah. What are you doing in this room? I says, I make brooms with my farmer and what else? And I'm listening to, you're listening to radio. I says, yeah, but when he mentioned radio, a chill went through my spine. I knew what he was after. And he says, what hears you? What do you hear on the news? I said, Schiene music. When I told him Schiene music, he grabbed the walking stick and hit me right over the head. I seen stars. And I looked at him like I didn't know what he was talking about. So he repeated it one more time. He started hitting me again. I started screaming. My farmer tried to come in and help me a little bit. He was confused too. He didn't know he's going to be shellacking me like that right away. And that's what I get nervous. I says, ich bin nicht schuldig. I'm innocent. You know, I speak in the both language. I says, you know, and I mean in German language, that's was nicht true, that this is not, it's not true. This is nicht wahr, this and that. I keep saying it, you know, and I keep looking at me. And he look at the farmer. He says, look at him. He looks like a milk and honey on the face because I look so pretty. I was a boyish guy, and I ate good on the farm, on the second farmer, so I was not undernourished. So naturally, he came in, took his handcuffs, and he handcuffed me to the back and come on to the train station. We marched to the train station, and I says, what's my future. Even then I tried to escape. When he took me overnight to Alsfeld prison, there was that I wasn't handcuffed, but I was in the cellar. There was a little window there. I tried to break the open. They noticed that somebody tried to open those bars to escape. Well, I didn't manage, I didn't have the strength to escape. So finally, in the next morning, I was on a train to Gießen. Gießen was a big prison. It was the headquarters of the Gestapo, and that's where they interrogate you. For the first 2 weeks, they didn't even call me. I already forgot about it. I said, perhaps they will never touch me.
And during those 2 weeks, what were the conditions where you were held like?
Well, there was a cell of about 12 by 15. There was about, not lying, about 15 to 20 prisoners. We had to sleep like herrings, side by side, leg between legs. And the place was deplorable. There were bugs walking, crawl, bug beds, and everything was walking on our walls. And even then, we had a certain humor. One guy put the line over there. He says, "You have a cigarette, who would ever fly you bed on it?" And we made the races with the flies. They were crawling to the line. Whichever fly crossed the line, you are the winner. And you get a couple of puffs of cigarette for it. You see, I mean, the humor you could not lose in prisons or other camps, because you become depressed. Depression sets in, and that's no good. You had to still have a sense of humor, because we used to make fun of those Germans, the uniforms, the way they were dressed with those stupid hats and all that. So,
what were the hygiene conditions like?
The what?
Was there a bathroom for you? Were there
bathroom? Yeah, one little pot in the corner of the room, and that's all. And you had to take it out. I mean, so many people. They let us out for half an hour in the morning at the Appellplatz. We had to march to exercise. But I've been there for a month and a half. The food came only once every 3 days.
What did they feed you?
Nothing. Water for 2 days. 1 day coffee and a bowl of soup. That was that. I survived like this for a month and a half. So in the morning, when they told you you go exercise, when you get up, I was dizzy. I had to wait till the blood rushes down, you know. I mean, we were getting exhausted. We were getting thinner by the day, and your mind started playing tricks. And from Gießen, I was sent to Buchenwald. Buchenwald concentration camp.
Did you know where you were going or what it meant?
No, but the soldier, the keeper in that prison said, "You're lucky you go to good working camp. They could have sent you to Auschwitz or Bergenau or other camps, you see."
And who told you you were lucky?
The guard, he says, in 2 days you're gonna be at Lassen. He joked. He says, you've been freed. You'll be at Lassen. I says, "Yeah, where are you going?" "To a good working camp." Working camp. I says, "Well, working camp can't be that bad, you know." And that working camp was Buchenwald by Weimar. Buchenwald was situated on top of the mountains. Weimar was the main town of Weimar, where Buchenwald was under it, you see.
How did they transport you?
By trucks. From Gießen all the way to Buchenwald by big trucks, army trucks, with the soldiers and the guns in the back of it, so nobody could escape. First of all, we came in by train to Kassel. Kassel was a nearby town before. That's where we came by train. And the next morning, by trucks to Weimar, and from Weimar right on top of the mountains with buses.
And what happened when you got there?
It was a sad situation. We arrive, I see all the writings on the wall, "Arbeit macht frei," "Work makes you free," and with the youngsters were segregated right away. They segregated 60 of us. Anybody with the political papers who was assigned to Buchenwald for political reason was supposed to be destroyed, no officially. They used to hang people and so forth, but they wanted to make a use out of it. So that's why I was designed to go to the experiment block number 46 which was inside Buchenwald, inside the electric wires. That block was surrounded by barbed wires again, and the windows were painted white, where you could not have contact with the outside wall. Outside wall, I mean the general population.
When you got there, what did they tell you was going to happen?
That you're going for rehabilitation. I says, well, rehabilitation, that's good. I didn't know what they meant, but they separate us. We had to march right around the Appellplatz, right into block 46. Once we came to the gate, two men in white uniform and a doctor received us. So we had to march in, we had to stay in line, and they just made us strip our clothes. They were delousing us, shaving us, and gave us quick showers with soap, and they gave us a new uniform. And then from there we went to general population, not general population, but to the main hall where the beds, there were 30 beds on each side, and tables in the middle. Peaceful music was playing, I could not understand. And I asked one of the doctor after a few days, after I befriended him, I spoke much better German. That's why I started learning German language right in that block, the experimental place. I had books, I would start write. I self-taught myself how to speak and write German. I never went to school. I never went to school in America how to speak English, and I have a little accent still, but I'm still doing okay.
And so they took you to the experimental block, but you didn't know it was experimental.
No. I asked the doctor, why are we here? Well, he says to me that every prisoner who was in prison for a long time comes here to be rehabilitated, you see. I says, gee, well, that's nice of them. I says, gee, if I knew that, I'd come here sooner. But I did not know that after 10 days, they were going to start feeding us with pills, spoonful of pills, some kind of pills that we had to eat, and eat porridge or farina. That's what there was, to eat farina, to swallow those pills. Twice a day for 2 days, we've been subject to eat that.
What were you told those pills were?
They were vitamins of some kind, a good nourishment with the food to get rid of the diseases.
And what kind of food were you fed besides the
porridge?
Well,
we had we were fed twice. We had breakfast in the morning, and we had porridge and haferflock, and what they call it in American language, the grain, white grain with milk, not farina.
Wheatina?
But
porridge.
Porridge, yeah, porridge, whatever they call it, yeah. Well, I forgot the name now. Funny, I forgot the name. So that was lined up with milk and stuff like that. Wheat.
Okay.
Wheat, cooked wheat, what do you call it?
Oatmeal?
Oatmeal, yes, there we are, oatmeal. I couldn't remember that. Okay. Oatmeal.
And what did you have for dinner? You said you had two meals.
Yes, for dinner, they even gave us some fruit. They told us that in the meantime, they expect us to do the beds perfectly. The beds were made with the checkered square sheets, and we had to use boards to bring it down, the headboard, and that was our job. But in the meantime, we were able to play games.
What kinds of games?
Well, games, sticks, pyramids, cards, dominoes, checkers, checker game. The Russians were very good. The place that they took us, 60 of us, was various nationality. There were Germans, Czechoslovakians, Russians, Polish, even Germans. So you see, the experimental place was designed for any nationality. If you are politically inclined, well, you are doomed for that.
Did people become friends with one another?
Oh, yes. In concentration camp, you all become friends. Maybe different nationalities, but the only difference between us was the different numbers that we carried, you see.
Yeah. And you said a few minutes ago that you were fed these pills, yes. And you thought they were vitamins.
Yes.
And what happened?
What happened? The third day, the dinner come late. I mean, the supper come late. So we ask questions, what happened? We're getting hungry, we're complaining because our stomach starts stretching now, see, we want more food. And they said, well, the dinner we laid, something happened in the kitchen, the cook spoiled it, whatever. But it will come, it will come. But in the meantime, he says, they brought us big bucket full of cold potato salad. Cold potato salad, German cold potato salad. So they gave us a spoon each, you know, and we start eating it, you know. And as we ate the whole thing. But we didn't know that typhoid was the ingredients in the potato salad, typhoid. So between the pills for 2 days and that cold potato salad they give us the germ of typhoid. They were not injections or like some people say, that we receive our typhoid through food. And within 2 hours, I struck my hair and I was hurting, My forehead was hurting, and I was getting chills, and everybody else, we were like soldiers becoming sick automatically within 2 hours. Okay? And of course, we begin to realize that there was little more to it than them just giving us late supper or pills as a vitamin. Each of us started to get angry, and some of them, due to the fever, they start exploring. And matter of fact, I seen one man hit a couple with Hygiene Institute, and he turned around, bent him, gave him injections, and I seen his body stretched, and that was the last of him.
Who was giving the injections and who was fighting?
Couple of the Hygiene Institute was the high prisoner who was a high doctor in the experiment place. He had another doctor under him by the name Walter. Then he had two helpers with the uniforms who deloused us. There were the only 4 people in this block. But that block was supervised by the SS uniform doctors who have supervised that. They have to report it to him, like I'm reporting to you, okay? Whatever happened there. Okay.
This is tape 3 of our interview with Henry Mikols. Mr. Mikols, you were talking about the experiment.
Yes, I like to stress the fact that the experiment block, whom doctors were working, were actually German prisoners with triangles and numbers. And of course, they had more authority than any one of us because they were designed to perform the experiments on us, and there were different various experiments which I could not even begin to come into it because I only speak about my experience. When I was sick, I seen people get high diarrhea, so was I. My pulse was going down. Other people had screamed, and they were, like I say, having a diarrhea, having a high temperature. I didn't have that diarrhea, but I had a high temperature. I hear only music playing in my ears. I don't know where the music come from, unless they put the Strauss waltzes and all that during the experiments to ease our pain. That doctor that come check on me, my pulse was going down. He worried about that. High temperature, he worried about that. And I says to him, doctor, could you please do me a favor? He says, yeah, what? Could you, I want to write a letter to my mother and my father. And he took a pencil and piece of paper, and I says, dear, in German, dear mother and dear father, I don't feel good, but God wants to take me with you. Since I'm Catholic and I believe in the religion, I have turned to my God for help. And he looked at me and he says, nein, du sterbst nicht. He says, no, you won't die. And all of a sudden, I seen two other white jackets in front of me, and they give me two injections in my chest. And I felt a burning sensation. And when they woke me up in an hour or two, my health was coming back to normal. My temperature was going down. They reversed my system. You see, the Germans had the serum. They had improved the serum on animals before, even typhoid, and they had a serum for typhoid. So they never used on humans. And I happened to be one of the humans whom they perform the serum for the first time.
Of the 60 people that you mentioned who were in this experimental block, yes, who were given basically the typhoid,
yes,
infection, how many were given the serum to counteract that?
I don't know, perhaps all, perhaps few, depends on the stage of the sickness. You see, there's complications with every temperature. There's people, I suppose, that have they may be sugar diabetes. They may be, they took those people from prison. Who knows what other illnesses they may have had in their life. I happen to be young and very strong. Maybe my heart was so strong that I survived this certain type of high temperature. And they revived me. From 60, only 8 of us survived, because as we were leaving later on through the gates, there was 8 of us. I counted on it, and that number is always in my mind. And of course, after the experiment, during the experiments, every bowel movement that we have done, there was specifically done in prospective with this wooden stick and on special containers. And that was sent to the German laboratory in Berlin. I even joked to my friend, I hope they serve this to Adolf on a platter. So we were supervised as far as the typhoid was concerned, because actually I feel that they developed the typhoid serum on my body, or improved the typhoid serum on my body. But right after the experiment, we seen the SS men, doctors were coming in. I never seen them before, but they looked like they were outsiders. I wouldn't be even surprised if Mengele was among them, because he was in that type of experiment. When I read from in the books from history that he even tried to change the pupils of a young children's eyes, he had performed experiments on muscles. Woman, he did perform many experiments in his life. One of mine was happened to be in the typhoid, and the typhoid was improved. And then I was asked by the SS, do you know why you here? I says, I play Greek. I says, no, I came here to be rehabilitated. That's right, he says. You don't see otherwise. They opened the window, they showed me the chimney of a crematorium. I was forbidden to talk to anybody about these experiments in Buchenwald. That's why that place was so secretly guarded. I would not say it to anybody, but I didn't have to. I came out a day in August. All the people that work on the constructions outside in the sun, they look Spanish comparison to me. I look like a milkman's son, you know, white, because I haven't seen sun for almost 2 months.
You mentioned that when these other doctors came in, they looked like they were from outside. Yes. What was it about them that made them look different than the doctors you had seen?
Well, they came over and the other prisoner doctor was explaining it just like you in normal hospital. The records was there, the name, and there, you look, their way of salute was, you know, shake their heads only. It's a typical German, you know, either they do that with the heels, you know, or Heisig, or whatever. So to us, they were kind of milder dispositions because they got out of us what they wanted.
The doctors inside, or the doctors outside?
SS doctors, the SS doctors. Of course, the prisoner doctors, the German prisoner doctors who performed the experiments on us, they were relating our experience to them. And they were the ones that continuously stay in that place for other particular experiments. So
okay.
I consider myself lucky that I went just through the typhoid. I could have been going through who knows what, germs. So.
What happened after you recuperated from the typhoid?
After the typhoid recuperation, they fed us again with good food. And finally, they said that we will be released to the general population. And that's why I was assigned to Block 16, where I received stripe uniform. I had to leave my uniforms in that building because that belonged to the that was the hospital uniform. We were getting jackets, not the one that's in the paper. I had another jacket before that, and uniform with a number, and I received number 2636 with a triangle and a P in the middle. And I look at that number, I said, wow, low number like this. I seen the other numbers, 26,000, 30,000, 32,000. I was proud of that number because I says, the smaller the number, the longer you are in concentration camp. And I just arrived, you know? So my first assignment.
If you had just arrived, how was it that you received the lower number? Why was that?
Well, if somebody dies or goes through crematorium, well, they just, statistically, they use your number, they give you the number from the one who died. They, even then, they will try to wipe out the populations. They didn't want to reveal how many people died. They kept a statistic as far as numerology was concerned together. So then I was assigned to block 48, I believe. There was a big warehouse where when the new prisoner comes in, the clothing, they were stripped from the civilian clothing and they will receive stripe uniforms. Okay. Those clothing, they say they were gonna be deloused, which they were. But from the deloused, those clothing were sent to a warehouse. And there were another couple and four men in charge of that. But I seen with my own eyes. Two guys ripping the clothes apart. I says, what are they doing? Somebody's clothes. I was conscious about it. I says, you have no right to tear somebody's clothes in. They were looking, when the Jewish transport came in there, they were looking for gold and diamonds sewed in the clothing. This is the way the black market started in Buchenwald, because they had gold and diamonds in Buchenwald, which they were able to do business with the German soldiers who brought them other goodies from the outside.
When you said they,
the prisoners who were in possession of diamonds and gold or coins or other valuable things that they were stripped from people who may be well-to-do, who had hidden things.
And what did they trade them for?
For alcohol. One friend told me, and I seen it, they received a bottle of brandy in a hot water bottle around the belly. Even the German soldiers were controlled from contact to go through the gate, but they smuggled that stuff in. They even smuggled nylon stockings for their sweetheart. They were a bordello. They have in Buchenwald, they had a bordello of 18 women who were in charge of all the political prisoners who are well working and behave, and they stay out of trouble. They were able to go for one mark, one German mark. First day they had to go to the hospital, they checked their throat, see if they have any lice, and then they were able to go to the, you had to actually report at your block, any block where you live, that you want to go zum Pufgehen, I want to go to the to this particular house, you know, with the woman.
What was it called?
Puff house, Puff, yeah. The prostitution there was. Those women were prisoners from Ravensbrück and from Auschwitz who volunteered to become for prisoners because they had German soldiers. The one I hear of, her husband died in the German front. And he died and she wanted his body to be buried in Germany and they would not allow it. So she started screaming against Adolf and Goering and everything. For that reason, she was in prison to Auschwitz. And women in Auschwitz worked with pick and shovel just like men did, you see.
What were the nationalities of the black market prisoners? You mentioned the black market before.
Well, I say it in the sense of black market. Black market started existing in 1945 after the war, where the money circulations were not worth nothing, where people have exchanged the German marks for American cigarettes.
Yeah, but the way it was used, yes. in the camp.
Yeah, well, the black market was, they had contact with the soldiers. You see, the soldiers who count you on the Appellplatz, when you come from work, you had to stand up, every camp will be accounted for, till they have the statistic that nobody was missing, you see.
But were certain prisoners, certain groups of prisoners from any particular company more involved in the black market than other prisoners?
No, those were the ones that have inside connections only. You could have been a capo or foreman on a outside detail work, and yet you had the connections to this particular soldier. You know, you knew which soldier was undertake, with whom could you do business. And for gold, the diamonds, and other jewelry, you could do everything. That's the way I'm calling a black
inside
market.
Inside information.
Inside information. So there could have been any nationality, and there were not stool pigeons, because if they found, if they would have squealed, they would have been punished just as much as the soldier. So there was a close comunicado, you see.
You also mentioned that, or I think you mentioned that the women who were in the bordello,
yes,
volunteered to do this?
Yes, they volunteer from Auschwitz and Ravensbrück now, for the prisoners.
Why would they volunteer? What?
They lost the country, they lost a husband, they were in prison, they become just like the rest of the population in the concentration camp. And they were subjected to heavy labor, and they came in from the cities. They were not cut out for farm work or city work. That's why they volunteer to shame more or less Hitler that we're Germans, but we will have affair with the foreigners.
So were these women, where were these women from?
They come from concentration camps.
Yeah, what nationalities were these?
German women, there were two Polish women, there was one Gypsy, there were Czechs, various different nationalities.
Did you ever go to the bordello?
Yes. I went only once, just to find out. I had no affair or nothing with it. That woman, after she found out what my name was, how old I was, she gave me a couple of cookies and a little glass of wine, and she sent me home. They didn't even have to delouse me. I mean, usually after the every experiment you went there, they had to do some kind of inject you with some kind of delusion so you would not spread up any disease. But to my amazement, the prominent prisoners who were there approached me. Henry, can I have your number? You put your number in a statistic. I give you bread, I give you soup. I made a business out of it. I put my name every week.
You put your name into?
To the statistic that I want to go to the bordello. But in place of me, my friend with using my numbers went in my place.
Why couldn't he use his number?
Because they were prominent, they were working in town. They knew a little more politics than I knew. They didn't want to be caught going there under their names. But in the meantime, the statistic knew about it, that you must have been a strong man. You go into bordello every week. Who? Transport to the tunnel work. That's why I went up in Nordhausen, in Erich Nordhausen. You see, I got... You, it's not funny, but a God's honest truth. They used me as a guinea pig that way too. And yet I was innocent.
Okay, what did these other prisoners who did not want to be known for going to the bordello, what did they give you when you'd...
Oh, hunk of bread, extra portion of soup, because they had everything. They were in control of the food. So they could throw a little here, a little there. They promised me that, you know, and I was hungry. I did this not for pleasure. I did this because I tried to survive from hunger.
Were the women in the bordello Jewish and non-Jewish? Were they all kinds of women?
Well, I don't remember. You see, in those concentration camps, unless they delouse you and find out who you are. Suppose you delouse you and they see you. Circumcised right away, you become Jewish. If you're not, well, you get away with certain things. But then they expose you to homosexuals. There was homosexuality in concentration camp. If you're a young boy and so forth, and somebody starts smiling at you, you know you better stay away from him because he's after you. And they promise you candies and others. They try to bribe you, bribe the young children. They become you. Big brothers of four, okay, and those were the circumstances in concentration camp. Maybe some of them were not homosexual or perverts or whatever, but they become, after so many years with no women and with being incarcerated or come from different prisons. You see, Buchenwald was a central concentration camp where people from different camps come in, and portion of them were shipped to the other camps. That's where Erich Nordhausen was created. The tunnel work I work in, that they were made for the V-1s, V-2 rockets that were hidden in those tunnels. Those rockets whom they were used against England. Okay, so. That's why the tunnel work we were helped build. I mean, they had German masters who did the major drillers and so forth. We were just cleaning up with jackhammer. But actually, the jackhammer was keeping us warm because the pressure and the vibration kept us warm. That was in the winter time working the tunnel.
Where did the tunnels go to?
And the mountains, they have shafts, air shafts. They were drilling those tunnels in through mountains area, just like you see in Colorado area, you see train goes through mountains, right, through tunnels. Well, that's the kind of tunnels that we were working on. And the Germans used those tunnels as a hideaway, stings probably that they stole from Europe, from other parts of the country, possessions, museums, and so forth. Those amber room from Russia, for instance, they're still looking for it. And many artifacts being found now by museums and some owners claiming them and so forth. But there's a market even today for relics like that.
Do you remember seeing specific things?
Specific thing, which you mean?
You said all these things were hidden. Was that because you just knew people had said it, that they were hidden? Or could you look and you could see there is something in particular?
No, not to that extent. But since Nuremberg 1945 in November, when the Nuremberg process started, I learned from England, from those processes or through TV, I learned about those artifacts from the history channels and so forth. That's even they're talking about it now, about the possessions of the museum pieces. Yes.
So you were working in the tunnels.
Yes.
And
every morning we were transported by the train. There's two stations, I mean, a few miles outside the camps, where they put us in a carload trains, and after we receive our breakfast, that's what we, I mean, our bread, piece of bread and camps. And that camp was getting skinnier and skinnier because food was scarce and scarce. And we went to work in the morning and they brought us back with the train in the evening, you see. But we were in a concentration camp with barbed wires, electrified also, just like Buchenwald was. And at one point, cannibalism was existed in Erich Nordhausen, because there were no crematorium. They were putting the bodies who died on a pile, they put them in kerosene, and they were burning them that way. Some of them were transported to major concentration camps like Buchenwald, where they had facility. But some of them who they could dispose, they would dispose in a pit, in a fire pit. Well, apparently the second shift who worked there, they discovered in Erich Nordhausen that when they turned the bodies, they had the hinds missing. That's why that was reported to the headquarters, down to the commandant, and they set up a trap and they caught those two men who were cutting the meat from those human bodies, selling that meat for exchange of cigarettes, in pretending there were meat from outside.
Who were these men?
Prisoners like myself and others, ordinary concentration camp prisoners. They.
How did you learn of this? How did you hear of this?
I was there. The commandant put those, they put a couple of barrels in and they stand those people right on top of the barrels so all of us can see. They told us that they the ones that eat human beings, that's against the religions and everything. They should talk about religion. Look what they did to us, you know. So that's why I like to stress this fact that the cannibalism has existed in Erich Nordhausen. Then come 1945, because I spent a year and a half almost in Erich Nordhausen, the rest before in Bergen-Belsen, in Buchenwald. Now, when the Americans and the British were pressing, the front was coming near. The last couple of days before that happened, they summoned the whole camp. They gave us a little can of meat and bread for four prisoners. They load us into the cow, freight trains, and they locked the doors and they sent us on a death train. That was the death train trip. They sent us to Bremerhaven and Hamburg, Bremerhaven. And since they could not go further, they were transporting us during the daytime. They wanted the Allied, the friendly fire, to bomb us while we were on the train, on the rails, you see. But thank God nothing happened to us. The intelligence apparently must have been so great that the pilots, the British, knew about it. They never bombed those freight. They knew the prisoners who existed in those trains. So we arrived. Every station we stopped, they were unloading dead bodies, putting on the side of the rail or trucks. Occasionally you see a farmer come with a sugar beets, truck of sugar beets. He'd been told that they have a cow, cattle. They're transporting cattle. The farmer came in with a couple of loads of sugar beets, and he seen there was nothing but humans in those trucks.
Why was he bringing the sugar?
He thought he was feeding the cows. There were cows. So whatever he unloaded, he took off. They threw those sugar beets inside the train. That was our pudding, our dessert. We ate that, you know, stomach deserved food. And they transported us like this, and I wind up in Bergen-Belsen on a station. That's where they start unloading us, and we made a march to the camp, which was about two and a half miles. We had to walk. And we seen Russian prisoners going one way, we were going the other way, and there was less soldiers protecting us, because we were marching right to the camp. And that's why from exhaustion. I fell down, I fall out of formation. And good thing two prisoners grabbed me, because, you know, if you go out of formation, they can shoot you. They will pretend that you want to escape. And I came back to myself, and finally I made it to Bergen-Belsen, to one of those blocks who used to be in the soldiers' camp. They made a concentration camp from Bergen-Belsen, Bergen was the old camp, but Belsen was the big camp. And there were kitchens in the middle, there were streets paved with asphalt, there were blocks, you know. They put us in those blocks. And the night before, when we hear artillery coming in, ours were coming, and planes, and they were shooting inside our windows from hatred, you know, shooting right inside the windows. And the second day, or maybe the third day, we hear a big tank came in right through the gate of Bergen-Belsen, and you see motorcycle with a sidecar with a machine gun. They took over the command of Bergen-Belsen.
They?
The British. The British soldiers. I was freed by the British. It was in Hanover, town of Hanover, outside Hanover, but Bergen-Belsen was in Hanover.
Do you remember what you felt when you saw them coming in?
Well, I says, God, maybe the time has arrived. Maybe I am chosen to survive, you see. And like I say, as we try to help each other walk in greeting those British soldiers, we got together, we were spread up with cigarettes and chocolates and by the British soldiers in their striped uniforms under notice. I weighed 80 pounds in 1945. 80 pounds.
We'll stop the tape here. This is tape 4. It's August 22nd, 2001, and we're interviewing Mr. Henry Mikols. Mr. Mikols, you were just telling us about the British coming and liberating Bergen-Belsen.
Yes. Never forget the moment, the moment that I cherish in my, for my life, actually. When I seen them British coming in, taking over the camp, we thought we were free already. But to my surprise, we were still under the German guns in concentration camp.
Even when the British had come?
Yes. All they did is disarm them from the ammunition. All they gave them is their white uniform, white band around their hand. So they give up the authority over us. But they wanted temporary, there was a temporary thing. They wanted us to keep the control of the camp, because you can imagine how much hatred was against the Germans.
I'm sorry, who wanted who to keep control of the camp?
The British. There was not enough. There was the first phase of the British army coming in and free the concentration camp. But you must understand, there was a chaos in concentration camp in Bergen-Belsen. There were people who hate people. There were Germans in there. There were all nationality. There were couples who have mistreated prisoners. They were taking revenge on each other. There were food shortage. They tried to run into those hospital who were German hospital with medicine. They were drinking. Some of the people were drinking medicine as alcohol. They would drink perfume, anything that had alcohol, especially the Russians, because they're straight vodka drinkers anyhow. But they, Hoffmannstropfen, there were little injections to boost your blood. They were drinking that. Many got poisoned. Some of the people who put their hands on greasy food, they died from diarrhea because they were their stomach would not take it. You see, and there was not to the third day that the Red Cross entered Buchenwald, Bergen-Belsen. The third day they arrived in Bergen-Belsen, and they take over. They created a temporary hospital, and they had volunteers. Even German nurses came there from Hanover. They start attending to save as many people as you can, because there were thousands of dead bodies lying everywhere on the doorsteps. People who tried to get into the canteen of the warehouse, they were shot by soldiers before the British came in, you know. There were I seen all this through the window while was happening, shooting, executions and stuff like that by the soldiers who were in possession of us. So I says, I'd rather die than go on the outside to go expose myself that way. But when the British arrived, they come on the motorcycles, and gosh, and we found the word came out that the British are here. Let's go greet them. They are our allies. And we were so desperate to meet somebody. We wanted to meet our freedom fighters, you know. And that's why I met this one fellow who was three times the size of me, and he says to me, "Are you Polish?" And the other fellow says, "Well, jak dosto zapole," means he thought he asked him if he was smoking cigarettes. And the other fellow prisoner says, "If you give me cigarettes, I will smoke," you know. But then finally we got together, he starts speaking broken Polish, and then we were Polish, and everything was about Polish, between cigarettes and the Polish language. And we found out that this soldier, this British soldier, was a Polish descent. He spoke few broken words in Polish, and oh, we start hugging each other. Well, we start crying, you know. And he took out cigarettes out of our pocket, out of his pocket, and chocolate, and start giving, distributing to us. One guy opened the package of cigarettes and lighted up. I took one puff, and I seen wheels coming around my head, and I fall down on the ground. I was automatically under the nicotine influence. And that was the first meeting with the British. And then, of course, we retreated to our barracks. And the second, third day was the Red Cross came in. And the day after, UNRA came in, UNRA, they call it, UNRA, who was in charge of all the displaced persons. See, they were organizing a new world at that time. In those camps, they registered you for your names, which city you come from, where you, what your mother and father name, and so forth. And the registration that was done by the UNRA and the Red Cross was sent to Poland, to various city where you come from. In my case, they went to Poznan, to Poznań. My mother never knew that I was still alive. In 1945, she already went to the Polish priest and gave it for the mass for me, you know, as I was dead. And there, in 1946, towards the beginning of 46, by the time all these transportations, the train started running, communications, by the time the Red Cross sent the message, there was already going to the end of 45, more or less, where my mother found out that that I was alive, that my name existed, that I'm a survivor of the concentration camp. Wherever I was, that was the biggest happiness for my mother. I understand from my brother and my sister saying, she was screaming all the way home to find out from happiness that I was still alive. Yeah.
You had mentioned earlier that the Germans were disarmed by the British.
Yes.
But that they were still running Bergen-Belsen. What was it that they were doing, and what was the response of the prisoners to these people who had been terrible to them.
The prisoners didn't know what was going on. They only seen different uniforms. They seen trucks with stars going by the road, the side of the Bergen-Belsen camp. They seen the tanks. The front was just moving. And they secretly, the guards that were holding us, they no longer were regular guards. They received a white banner, and they disarmed them from ammunition.
And but what
light
was
ammunition.
What was the response of the prisoners? What did they want to do to these Germans?
The reason they were there to keep us indoors. They didn't want to have them come out. They were pretending that we're still prisoners till they were organizing the camp. That's the reason.
Okay. And then you mentioned the Red Cross came.
Red Cross.
You were, as you mentioned, you weighed 80 pounds.
80 pounds.
And so what happened to you?
They took me on a stretcher to the block, the temporary design block, and I was deloused. They scrapped my feet and my arms, and there were German soldiers, sanitarius we call it, first aid men who not only that they volunteer, but they were forced to become carrying the dead bodies on the side and the live ones to the hospitals. And of course, all the prisoners that came from different camps, they carry typhoid, they carry all kind of diseases. They had to bring this under control so the epidemic would not start in Europe, you see. That was the reason. And of course, the main reason was to feed us with straw liquid only to build our stomachs so we could start live again.
Do you remember?
It was tough days, you know. I talk about it, and I try not to be sentimental about it, but me telling the story to you today is just like happened yesterday. And I always want to tell somebody that, but nobody wants to listen. You're the only people from Shoah Foundations that want to know the facts. Well, this is the facts. This is exactly the way it happened. I'm sure I'm not the only one who tell you people what I went through. And sometimes I think I'm one of the chosen one. I sometimes think I live through all this so I'll be able to explain it to the American people, to the Shoah Foundations, to the world, you see. That's it.
When you started to say that that was one of the toughest times while you were starting to gain your health back, in particular, what was so tough about it?
Well, you had mixed emotion. Here you feel you're doomed. I never dreamed that I ever gonna be free in my life. I was sent to concentration camp for life. I was a life prisoner. No chance of parole, no chance of getting out. I was supposed to serve the masters, the Master Reich. So on the end, when the end comes, and here you see you're no longer a slave, you have allies that freeing you. You start coming back, you see we were brainwashed through all the time in concentration camp. We were brainwashed by the situations we were in, the sickness we endured, the hunger we had to suffer. Well, I was with intelligent people, with intelligentsia. I was in Buchenwald. They had the orchestra from the Warsaw Concerto. There were Jewish orchestra. They were playing waltzes and everything else for the amazement of the Nazis. The Nazis have special club, and they had a special top musicians to be entertained. See, they believe like any other soldiers in the country, God mit uns, God with us, or we have it in ours, in God we trust. You see, yet we being taught how to murder people. There's something wrong with the logic of this whole thing. But I found myself began to get my librium together and dreaming about that I am free. I tried to pinch myself, make sure that it's true, that it's not just a dream, you see, that we are being freed. And when we seen Red Cross with the banners and speaking English, I knew they were not German because I could not speak English at that time. I says, must be true, must be true. When they set up temporary showers and water, they restore water too in Buchenwald and all that. And the temporary shelters were first the huts, soldiers' tents and stuff like that. The sick ones, they were sent by ambulances to Hanover, to hospital, to the German hospital. The German volunteer to help too, you see. There was a moment where all of a sudden, everything was forgotten. Now they want to repair everything in 24 hours. Yet people were dying regardless of the help by the British. People were dying from exhaustion. Some of them, have you seen the skeleton I seen? The bodies was piled up. But even though, I wasn't scared no more because I said, well, today is them, tomorrow maybe me. Till we seen the British coming, till I've been told by all the people than me, that's true, it's true, we be free, we go to Poland, we see our country. And instead, what happened? After Germans lost the war, we were invaded by the communists. And one more word I wanted to say, I received a new title. I became a displaced person, man with no country. It took me all those years, to 1948, I left Germany for England. In England, I wasn't a British subject. I came to the United States. I had to wait 5-6 years to become American citizen. All those years, from 1939 to 1959, I was a displaced person, man with no country.
What happened after you were, you became healthy under the care of the Red Cross. And what did you think you'd be doing next?
Well, I received words that my brother was looking for me. They seen somebody by the name Mikolajczak in Düsseldorf or Solingen. So I tried to reach those camps to meet somebody, because in 1945, the trains were not working, transportations were cut off, the Germany was bombed, like you see, it was last day of Pompeii. Well, I'm using this phrase only as a last day of Pompeii. But as I become free, stronger, there was UNRA taught us how to drive cars, how to drive trucks, because they need a young generations, new drivers, to distribute food among displaced person camps. I learned how to drive Austin ambulance with the Red Cross. I was driving one of them. I was taking two or three women with children to Bremen and Hamburg to the Polish ships, people who were going back to Poland. You see, the displaced person under United Nations allow you to go back to your country. They give you food for 1 month and some money to start your life all over again. If you did not want to go to Poland, you become a displaced person under the Act of United Nations. You could go to England, you can go to Australia, you can go to Canada, except United States, you had to have a sponsor.
Why did you not go back? What? Did you consider going back to Poland?
I considered go back to Poland right after the war. But when I seen people who went to Poland came back and told us what the communists were doing, all the rapes and robberies and how they were mistreating Polish people, and people, soldiers from the Polish army under the Anders army from Italy, they were discharged, they came to Poland, they were considered spy by the Russians. People turned me off of me going back to Poland. All I needed is to get in touch with my parents.
Were you able to get into contact with either your parents or your brother?
Only through letters, later on through letters. I haven't seen my parents. My father died in Switzerland in the meantime, tried to go get some money from the bank. and he disappeared. We never hear of him again. He died apparently in one of those mischievous concentration camps. Then the transportation was so bad during the right after there was no connections with Poland via telephone or via trains. So I decided to stay in Germany. Being a displaced person, we received clothes from United States of America, packages and all that. We thought we hit the jackpot, you see. But in the meantime, we tried to go to different country, and I was the advantageous type. I wanted to see United States someday. Since I could not go to America because I had no relations, living relations in America, I went to England first. In 1950-51, I started writing to the Catholic organizations in New York, and they sponsored me. So I had to pay my own passage, and I was going to book a plane at that time.
What were you doing? But after you left Germany, you went to England.
To England
and
first.
What kind of work did you do there?
Oh, in England, I worked at the gas company first. We were cleaning filters. It was a dirty job, but there was a paycheck every week. In the meantime, I found out another company by the name Paladin Trailer Company. I learned how to assemble camping trailers on piecework. You get so much money per every assemble. Me and my friend Johnny, who's still in England right now, we communicate. That was my job in England till I received a word that I was able to go to United States. All I had to do was pass my physical examination, receive passport, and pay my own passage. So I was gonna fly over it. King George died at that time when I was making passage to go to United States. And the plane cost so much money, like 156 pounds or something. And I didn't have that much money. But the girl in the travel agency, she says, "Mr. Mikols, we have one bed only, a second class on a Queen Mary. Would you be interested?" I says, "My God, would I be interested?" "Yes." So I came over on a Queen Mary to New York. On the Queen Mary, I met a couple of Jewish people. Somehow, I've always run to Jewish people. They're the first ones who helped me in Hampton. They come from Hampton, New Hampshire. The name was Henry Weber. I met them on the Queen Mary. They promised me a job and a home to stay till I get on my feet, you see. And that's why I stuck by them. When I came from Staten Island there, back to meet them, took the 2.5 hours by the time they released me from over there. They waited for me. They booked a hotel for me overnight. They stayed in the cousins. They have cousins in New York. And in the morning, they got the car from parking where they storage the car. And we were traveling in from New York. While in New York, I was walking Broadway. I see those skyscrapers and I start to cry from happiness, because I says, "Gee, my dream come true, you know. Here I am in the middle of New York and enjoying the taxis and all the people around, and wherever I look, I see 50 feet in the sky, a guy washes the window. I couldn't understand that, you know." Next morning, Mr. Weber and Mrs. Weber told me, "Here's the address, here's the money for taxi, and you, when you get up from the hotel, you go have a breakfast, and you take the taxi, you come on this address. We'll be waiting for you." And so it happened. So I came in with the taxi, and he was looking for tip, but I didn't have enough money for tip. I said, "Just come to the country." I spoke with a Polish-Russian accent, you know. He says, okay. And I waited, they come meet me. We came in with a car to Boston, you know, and all the time I keep looking. I said, gee, where's those skyscrapers? I thought the whole United States was nothing but skyscrapers, you know. It's a fantasy still in my life, in my head, you know, that I dreamed about it. So finally we came to Boston, we stay overnight. They have a famous lawyer to the Webbers, he's in Boston here, you see. And we met them. And that's what I meant about a dozen rabbis. There was a big table, about 24 people, food to the galore, and they asked me all kinds of questions, and they start talking Jewish.
What kinds of questions were they asking?
Well,
you?
Where I'm from, and how I come here to America. They wanted to see here how things are in England, what the market and housing property is worth.
Were they asking you about your experiences in the war?
No, because Mrs. Weber didn't know too much about me either. They just hear that he's a Holocaust survivor. You see, we didn't have a chance to explore and talk about everything that I'm telling you now, you see.
And you said there was a lawyer in Boston.
Yes.
Who is the lawyer? Do you not remember the lawyer's name?
I can find out through Mr. Weber's son, who they related, you see. Okay.
But what was the purpose of the lawyer, and why did they bring you to all those rabbis?
Well, the lawyer was Mrs. Weber's sister's husband.
And why were you meeting with him?
Because we came from New York, and it was getting late, and they were waiting as a receptions, because this Mr. Weber was an antique dealer. He had business throughout Hampton areas, beaches, and so forth. And he went, his purpose to go to Europe, he went to France, England, France, Italy, and England. He bought half of the size of this room, boxes full of antiques, which he was auctioneer, see? And he was coming back on a Queen Mary from England. That's why I met the Webbers. And they stopped in New York overnight first. The second trip was Boston destinations. They were already waiting for them with a big, you know, they were all business people and stuff like that. And then the next morning we left Boston for Hampton, New Hampshire. This is, you know, even the houses were even smaller than. So I was surprised, but I get used to. I had my first haircut in Hampton, New Hampshire, and Mrs. Weber didn't like it because they spoiled my hair. I you know, I was a little spivvy when I came in from England, you know, speak the dialects and all so forth, yeah. So I was very grateful that the Jewish family seen in their heart to give me the first break. I always cherish that. And that was kind of a beginning of my new life in America.
And what did you do in Hampton, New Hampshire?
Well, I paint for them the cabinets. I stripped furniture from Vanish so he could resell it, you know. I was very helpful to him. They could not pay me much, but I just wanted the room and board. That's all, to help him out. In the meantime, I met a British family in Hampton, New Hampshire. They were related to Dale Blackton from Merrimack, who employed carpenters, and he offered me a job, you know, so much per hour, dollar an hour at the time I was getting, you know. And of course, when they see me working with blisters on my hands, he gave me a couple of raises. This is where I learned how to become a carpenter. He was the first contractor that taught me how to remodel a house, and went in my blood. From there on, I knew that I had not much education. I had to have a trade to survive, and I was willing worker, and I became a carpenter, you see, working on a highway constructions in Westboro, drilling, and then back into carpentry. Then I worked for Parini in the Army base in Boston here, extending the piers. Well, work with the divers. I'm the one who was on the 100 feet up in the air, releasing the cement into the chutes, into the divers in Boston Harbor. And then I moved around. I moved from Newburyport to Lawrence, Massachusetts. From Lawrence, Massachusetts, of course, I got married in Lawrence. And we have four sons.
When you got married, was your wife a survivor?
No, she was Italian descent. Matter of fact, we got married May 2nd, 1954, and we went on our honeymoon to New York. And to my amazement, being in New York, I ran into a show, On Your Account, with Wynne Elliott, and they were so interested in my life story that they came to us, asked us to stay for a few days, and they prepared a show. My life story was prepared on Channel 4 in New York in 1954. I have the scripts with me and everything.
When you met your wife, who is American, did you share with her all that you had been through?
Oh, yes. Yes, but at that time, you see, the funny part about concentration camp, even in England, when you are at a concentration camp, you don't even want to tell everybody that you are a prisoner. You know, we started a new life. We wanted to leave the past behind. We did not talk much about, in America, about this concentration camp with my wife. She did not understand all this anyhow. Till later on, when the Holocaust started being publicized more and more, then it comes Schindler's List and others. Well, everybody starts speaking out. But I've been speaking out since 1945 on that subject. So finally, I have a chance to speak to you today.
I know you had a family. You had four sons with your wife. Did you ever talk with your sons about your experiences?
Yes, matter of fact, my oldest son is so enraged. He's so fanatically inclined to history. He can tell me more about Europe than I can tell him, you see. So study a lot, yes. And we have common ground with our sons on that. And of course, my first marriage went sour. I remarried. I married my new wife, Alma, and we have a daughter.
New as 25 years, right?
Yes.
Okay. We'll end this tape here.
Yes.
This is tape number 5. It's August 22nd, 2001, and we're interviewing Mr. Henry Mikols. Mr. Mikols, before the last tape ended, you mentioned that you had a new wife, second wife.
Yes, I met my second wife 25 years ago, and we've been struggling, but good fortune came down to us where I finally got reimbursed by the German government, a lump sum of $10,000 for being in concentration camp. I used that money to buy my promised land in Dahmer, New Hampshire, in which I built my new home, and I've been living there ever since.
And I understand you have a daughter?
We have a daughter, yes. About the same age, and she graduated from Colby Sawyer College. That college, when she went into, she kept asking me if I could come and lecture in her classroom in front of the student about the Holocaust. I was resentful to do that, but finally, my daughter's persistence, I bent down and I said, okay.
Why were you resentful or resistant?
Well, it seems like so many years after the Holocaust, people keep talking about it, and you just hate to talk about it unless somebody who's interested, wants to hear, then I will go into the detail.
You mean really interested?
Yes, exactly. So happened, I've been invited first by one professor of Angelica, and we supposed to talk in a college, but since we couldn't go, had like an empty classroom, we went to the restaurant And he asked me questions to talk about the Holocaust while he ordered me a steak. Now, how can I talk about Holocaust and the hunger in front of the steak? Well, that was the first encounter with that professor. But the second professor, Miss Ewald, her name was, she had a nice talk with me. She would like to hear me speak to the class of 20, 30, 50 people. I says, wow, I don't know how I'd be able to do it. I'm not a professional speaker, but in the name of young generations, I would like to talk to them. And I made the arrangements at that time, and I had spoke to the classroom. To my amazement, I talked for 1 hour and 15 minutes. I encourage all the young generations about become goodwill ambassadors, to get entangled with other nationality children and have exchange student programs and so forth. I extended many wishes to even their parents about not to forget to say they love their parents, you see. I even said that they maybe why not with a brand new car if they do that. They like that kind of idea.
When you spoke with them, what was it that you really wanted to impart to them?
I like to tell the young generations, because in America today's stories is forgotten tomorrow, and I don't want this to be forgotten, and I want kind of indicate to the young generations about there was such a thing as Holocaust, that there were people who were murdered, who were taken against their wishes, and how lucky they are born in this country where they didn't have to go through all that.
What was their response when you told them of your experience?
It was just great. They gave me a big applause, and the news spread around among the teachers and professors. And finally, on one Easter morning, my daughter comes in with a big letter telling me that the college inviting me to be taking part of the graduations right next to my daughter. So that was quite a surprise to me. I never expected that. But after they hear my speech, after they seen my memoirs, they thought that I deserved that. And for me, a man with six great education, speaking four languages, went up on a podium receiving a diploma. Yeah. So that was very touchy to me. At that time, of course, I have my wife Alma, who was very ill. She lost both of her kidneys, and we had been doing dialysis at home for 2.5 years. We struggled, hoping for another sign, and we finally found the light at the end of the tunnel, and we went to one hospital, and they told me that I was too old, because I was 71.
To be a donor.
To be a donor. And so we went to Boston, and we had the green light from there, because in Boston, I asked first the doctors, how old do you have to be a donor? Oh, well, there was an 81-year-old grandfather gave a kidney to his grandson. I said, oh my God, I have a chance then, you know. So I asked to be tested. Our blood matched, and so to our surprise, they said I can be a donor. I did not hesitate. And we went through the operations with flying colors. Today it's three years almost since my wife has my kidney, and she's doing well. I even joke around with her, tell her that she's half Polish. That's about all about me so far. And I'd like to thank the Shoah Foundation for giving me the opportunity to be televised in such a manner where I can be able to express my past and future thoughts. And occasionally I wonder why I survive. Who knows? Maybe I'm one of the chosen ones. Maybe I survive so I can tell this to the American people, to the Shoah Foundation. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Hello. On the left is my wife, Alma Mikols. She is Guatemalan born. And on my right is my daughter, Angelica, American born. And my name is Henry Mikols.
Thank you very much, Henry.
I was born in Poland.
And you've been in the United States for quite a while now.
Since 1952.
And you have this wonderful family. And this is the wife you referred to.
Yes.
Okay. How do you think your experiences affected how you brought up Angelica?
Well, I would like to have her speak for herself.
Angelica?
I think it gave me a different point of view on the values in life. Just different from a lot of my peers or a lot of my colleagues. I have a different perspective. I realize that big issues really aren't as mind-blowing as they are in the whole scheme of things. It kind of grounds you. You appreciate everything that you have.
When did you first learn of your father's experiences?
I think I've always known to some degree, but I can remember when I was 9, driving with my dad up to our camp. We had a father-daughter weekend, and I remember sitting in the car with him, asking him stories to try to get a better idea of exactly what he went through. And at 9 years old, you really don't understand, and over the years, I grew to actually get a bigger perspective of what happened to him and understand how that was different than how I was growing up.
Okay.
There was one moment that we spoke because she had to write a biography about Annie Franks. And that's more or less where all this started. We still have her biography that she wrote when she was in...
In sixth grade.
Yes.
I was 10, 10 or 11.
Yes.
Alma, and we know that part of you is half Polish, or at least one of your kidneys is.
Yes.
And you have a husband who has sacrificed in many ways over his lifetime. And would you like to say some words about him?
Well, when I met him, he talked about his experience. And the more I knew him, the more I got to know all the experience that he went through. And I admire him for the way he is so generous, especially he sacrificed for me to give me part of his body, his wants. And then he is very generous to many people who he even doesn't know who they are. And it makes a big difference that really I admire him for all he went through and the guy who he is to us.
Okay. Mr. Mikols, what would you like those of us who've heard your story, those of us who are going to be listening to your story, what would you like us to be left with? What feeling or what thought or what wisdom would you like us to be left with, having heard everything you've had to say? What do you think is most important to tell future generations?
Most important for future generations is to tell the truth and fight with all the might to curb all the dictators in this world and not to be prejudiced and live one love one another as a human being, because we are only on this earth for a little time. So I encourage to spread the news, not just because of my story, but there is millions of others who are still surviving, also thousands of us dying every day. And this documentary, I suppose, is for this particular reason, so the truth of yesterday will never die off.
Thank you. The last question is, I know you were brought up with a strong faith. You were brought up Roman Catholic. And You've mentioned in the course of the interview thanking God, and despite everything you've gone through, you still believe in God. And has your experience in any way affected your beliefs?
To a certain extent, I always, even though I was a strong Catholic, and I'm still a Catholic, but I believe in the Creator, and I'm against hatreds in certain religions, and I'm sure I would never touch myself alive and try to kill other people. That's fanaticism to me. I like to live and let live, and believe in other human beings. I take people only that they're all good. Only if they show it to me that they're different, then I have a different opinion about them. But we're living in such a wonderful country with all the opportunities. I can thank you enough. I love America. And God bless America.
Thank you very much. Thank all of you.
This picture was taken in Poznań, Poland in 1926. It is my first Christmas with the Christmas tree behind. On the right is my father, Stanley Mikolajczak. On the left is my mother, Joanna Mikolajczak. And my name, which is now hieronym Henry Mikols, is in the middle. I'm 1 year old. This is a picture of my father, Stanisław Mikolajczak, taking about 1937 in Poznań, Poland. The only souvenir I have from him. This picture is a picture of my mother in the early 1950 I haven't seen her for a long time. I haven't seen her till 1965. At that time, she could not leave my country because my country was occupied by Russians, and they had Stalin wouldn't allow her to come out of the country. So I had to wait till 1965 to meet her in the United States for the first time since the war. Her name is Joanna Mikolajczak, born in Poznań, Poland, and she is my mother. She was very ill at that time. She had both of her legs paralyzed. The doctors told her that she would not be able to walk. But she surprised them all. She survived through that. In 1964, I brought her over to this country. I found a job in 1965. She worked for General Lawrence Hospital in Lawrence. And she worked there for up to 1971. She was able to even get her Social Security pension, and that helped her a lot in Poland when she returned in 1971. She was 96 when she died, and she was my mother, whom I love very, very much. Thank you. This picture is of me. My picture of Henry Mikols from Germany in Düsseldorf while I worked for the British Army and CGG control of Germany. And that picture was taken in 1946 and beginning 47. And this is the only picture I had since. Like I say, I work for the British government, driving offices around Düsseldorf, Germany, in Rhineland. 58, yes. Okay. See? This is a Henry Mikols, citizen papers. I become citizen in 58, I believe. And this is my certificate. I'm very proud of that one. I have a display on a wall, and I cherish it with my life. That dictates only that I am American citizen and give me the right and more right than I had while I was in Europe. This picture is of Henry Mikols, myself, of course. It was taken in 1965 when I went to Poland for the first time since the war. And I happened to visit the town of Zakopane, which is the mountains that border Czechoslovakia. And I have this portrait made to my liking. It's before I was wearing glasses. And I'm very proud of the picture too, that represents the mountaineers with the original uniform and a fancy hat. Okay. This picture are Mikols' family, my four sons. On my left is my son, the oldest son, Stanley Mikols. In the middle is my third oldest, Robert Mikols. On the right is Salvatore Mikols, and the little one on the horse is my son Joey Mikols. Those are my four sons.
Where was it taken?
This photo was taken in North Andover, Massachusetts. In the 70s, according to the ages, 70s and 60s, yes. This is picture of Henry Mikols, who in front of it is my concentration camp jacket that was taken in November 1994 in Berlin, New Hampshire. This jacket states my concentration camp number 2636, which I had in concentration camp, and above it is a triangle with a letter P. That was the insignia that was given to us in concentration camp.
What did it mean?
That only means the political prisoner, since there's a red triangle means political prisoner. Well, this jacket was with me for all those years since after the war. I had carried that from Germany to England, from England to United States. And at one time, I wanted to donate the jacket to Auschwitz Museum in Poland. I sent it to Poland to my friend. He kept that jacket, did not give it to that concentration camp, because at that time, Poland was under the communist rules. So when I went to Poland for the first time in 1965, this jacket was presented to me by my friend again as a present. So I was very happy to see it, and I put this jacket in my suitcase. We just changed directions, and I brought this jacket to America. Well, I like you people to know that this jacket is hanging in the Washington Holocaust Museum on display for viewers to examine and see. So if you're ever in Washington in the Holocaust Museum, as for Henry Mikols' jacket, number 2636. Thank you. This picture represents a diploma from Colby Sawyer College, where I graduated from, with bachelor degrees, and they honor me, the college honor me, because of my speaking on the Holocaust. And I am very proud of this diploma. And when I ever leave this world, I will carry this with me, and I'm gonna show it to all my friends out there that I made it. Bachelor, honorary bachelor of arts degree. In 1997, the year of it.